Hello YouTube, Bane666 here. Yeah, I know this video has been a long time coming. I actually started it about a year ago now and then got distracted with other projects and never finished it. So you'll note that about half of it is the old text-to-speech and the other half is my voice. So you'll be able to tell the new and the old apart quite easily. I highly recommend that you watch the previous episode, link below, before watching this. So anyway, without further delay, let's get stuck into it.
Hello YouTube. Bane666 here. Welcome to my new series, where I explore some of the fallacious, inconsistent, or ludicrous claims of discrimination, or oppression, made by modern-day Western feminists. So let's get stuck into it. If you haven't watched the previous episode in this series, I suggest you go and do so now before watching this one. In the last episode, I broke feminist patriarchy theory down into three components. 1. There are no differences between the sexes, apart from genitalia, and all gender identity is a social construct. 2. Society has been constructed by males, for the benefit of males, and at the expense of females. And 3. Males did this by force. In essence, females have been subjugated by a masculine, tyrannical force for the entirety of human history. Last episode, I showed strong evidence that gender is not just a social construct, as feminists believe, but is a complex combination of genetics and societal norms. I also explored the origins of gender roles, gynocentrism and male disposability. In this episode, I will be exploring the second of the 3 points. That society has been constructed by males, for the benefit of males, and at the expense of females.
So, sexism. Human beings have been around for about 130,000 to 150,000 years, give or take. And every single society in that time period has been sexist against women. Men have been in charge in every country, every time period, ever. So there's never been a matriarchal society in history. In fact, every society has been patriarchal. And for most of human history, the question is not which societies are sexist and which ones aren't sexist. It's which societies are less sexist. So
humans evolved to survive their surroundings. They adapted over hundreds of thousands of years. Those adaptations that worked, or were beneficial, were passed on, and those that didn't work, or were no longer working due to a change in environment, died out, or became redundant. The evolution of human society ran a similar course. Those things which were harmful to reproduction became taboo. For example, incest, at least to my knowledge, is universally condemned, because reproducing with your brother, or sister, or mother, or father, increases the likelihood of deformed offspring. And those things that were beneficial to a society, like traditional gender roles, and male disposability, became the cornerstone of prosperous societies. That's why it's ludicrous to view the bulk of human history from the viewpoint of benefiting males and disadvantaging females. Society and traditional gender roles were not built for the benefit of males, but for the benefit of reproduction. Traditionally, both genders had advantages and disadvantages, both had important roles centered around the survival of the species. And both had responsibilities.
Now, to kind of illustrate further how men could have enjoyed higher status than women while simultaneously having more burdensome and difficult lives, actually getting the shorter end of the stick, the worse deal, all that. Let's look at an extreme case of a staunchly and severely patriarchal society, an arrangement that was relatively unheard of in hunter-gatherer cultures. The Inuit. Now, in most hunter-gatherer societies, gender roles are just as differentiated as in any traditional society. But male and female roles usually commanded similar levels of social status, respect, and admiration. This was not the case with the Inuit. But one of the really, really striking ways that the Inuit societies differed from other hunter-gatherer societies was that in most hunter-gatherer societies, men and women brought in roughly the same amount of food. In fact, sometimes women brought in the larger share. And they maybe didn't become dominant or have higher status than men because they didn't risk their lives to bring in the food that they brought in the way that men were expected to in the act of hunting. But the Inuit were really, really different from that. Not only did men bring in more than 95% of all the food, they did so at extreme risk to their lives and health, under conditions more severe than the conditions almost anywhere else on Earth. Rates of injury and premature death among Inuit men of the past were horrendous. You know, here are a bunch of guys who were expected to go out in a damn kayak in 40 below weather and chuck spears at whales 200 times their size. Or go out on treacherous ice that if you fell through it meant almost certain death to hunt seals, in order to bring home way more meat than they could possibly eat by themselves, and share that meat with the women and children who had gotten to stay home safe and sound. Now, I'm wondering what you think would have happened if you had convinced those men that their wives needed them like fish need bicycles. You know, what do you think would have happened to women as a result of that? What if you told those men that this woman and these children aren't yours, right? They don't belong to you. Therefore, you have neither the right to dictate to them nor any responsibility to take care of them. You know, what if you said that women are every bit as capable as men and they're men's equals in every single way that matters? What if you'd actually convinced men of that? Heck, what if you'd actually convinced Inuit men that women's work was just as important and prestigious as men's work? You think maybe a lot of men would have taken up sewing? You know, those Inuit men who could have, if they'd wanted to, just gone off on their own. You know, I'm just gonna go off by myself, club a baby seal every month or two, and I will do just fine, since chewing pelts into fur and stitching them into clothes really isn't that hard. And, you know, I'd have plenty of free time to do that without all those extra mouths to feed. You think maybe those men would have chosen not to risk and sacrifice like Inuit men did if all they got was the same rewards and status that Inuit women did? Do you really think those men would have, or should have been expected to, risk and sacrifice the way Inuit men did for the same rewards and social status as Inuit women? You know, or would those men have said, hey, she's my equal and she's her own person and her kids don't even belong to me either. Let her get her own food. Because you know what? That's exactly what I would have said if someone had convinced me of all of that. I mean, hasn't it ever occurred to you or to any other feminist that the most extreme patriarchies occur in the harshest living conditions? Really? You know, do you think any of those Inuit women would have been better off, you know, less oppressed by being seen as equal to their men? Equal, and therefore in no need of men's provision or protection. You know, you ever wonder what it might have been like to be a pregnant Inuit woman out on the ice trying to find a seal and jab a stick in it so she could eat? You ever think that maybe, just maybe, she might have been perfectly happy trading something valuable in order to secure the cooperation and support that imposed such hideous costs and risks onto him? You ever think that maybe her survival in that environment was so dependent on him risking life and limb every time he went out that she might have actually thought social status and personal autonomy were really small prices to pay in exchange for what it cost him to give her what she needed? You ever think that maybe marriage wasn't a way to force women to become slaves to men? You know, bear men's children and provide them with free domestic services the way so many second-wave feminists have portrayed it, but maybe it was a way to force men to become slaves to women, to support women's children and provide provisioning and protection services to women? You ever wonder? Just maybe it was both? Oh my God, I just blew my own mind.
Male disposability is not a privilege. Working yourself half to death and providing is not a privilege. Defending your family, tribe, or country is not a privilege. That's not to say that everything was perfect for females either. Childbirth came with great risk. And although society protected females more than males, this protection also came at a cost. Let me give you an analogy. Imagine a mother with two children. One child, the mother loved intensely, while the other she didn't care for at all. The child she didn't care for was forced out into the dangerous world to fend for himself and bring back food for the mother and the loved child. While the loved child was kept inside, safe and protected, but also sheltered and restricted. Which child has it better? One child has protection, but at the cost of freedom. The other has freedom, but with the burden of responsibility and the cost of disposability. In a fair world, both children would have equal levels of freedom, responsibility, and protection. But for the vast majority of human history, the world was never fair to either gender. This all comes from female reproduction being limited and male reproduction not being limited. Society was not built on female oppression, but on the acceptance of male disposability and female reproduction. But let's look at some examples used by feminists to show that women were historically oppressed.
Two-thirds majority in the case of more...
Be quiet! I order you to be quiet!
Order? Who does he think he is?
I'm your king.
Well, I didn't vote for you.
You don't vote for kings.
Well, how'd you become king, then?
The Lady of the Lake. Her arm clad in the purest shimmering samite held aloft Excalibur from the bosom of the water, signifying by divine providence that I, Arthur, was to carry Excalibur. That is why I'm your king.
Listen, strange women lying in ponds distributing swords is no basis for a system of government. Supreme executive power derives from a mandate from the masses, not from some farcical aquatic ceremony.
Be quiet!
Oh, but you can't expect to wield supreme executive power just because some watery tart threw a sword at you.
Shut up!
It's not uncommon to hear someone say, women didn't even have the right to vote, as if all males, throughout history, have had the right to vote. Some will even come right out and state in sheer anger that men have always had the right to vote. I guess I have to ask the question. What type of elections did cavemen have? But history is a little more complex than that. Humans have been around for roughly 200,000 years. What we might term civilization has been around for about 10,000 years. Ancient Greece and Rome had democratic systems. Although voting was limited to very few individuals within a society, what we know is the modern democratic system started around 500 years ago. But once again, voting was extremely limited to those in positions of power and wealth, and over time, the franchise spread to encompass more and more people.
In England, voting rights were always historically linked to land ownership. If you owned property, you could vote. You could even have more than one vote if you owned enough. However, if you didn't own land, you couldn't vote. It was that simple. So in this scene here, while these brave women fight for the vote, look at the policemen. Policemen primarily lived in boarding houses and didn't own land. That's right, the policemen arresting her didn't have the vote either. Before the first Reform Act in 1832, roughly one man in ten had the right to vote. After 1867, the time of the second Reform Act, this figure rose to four in ten, as the amount of property you needed to qualify was reduced. More men qualified, but most men were still disenfranchised, principally because only one man in any one household was allowed to vote, denying any resident sons and brothers. From 1918, all women over the age of 30 could vote, and all men over the age of 21. Then, finally, absolutely equal rights to vote were introduced with the Equal Franchise Act of 1928. We can see from this that the right to vote in England up until 1918 was always about class and never about sex. Only the 10-year period between 1918 and 1928 could legitimately be claimed to be discriminatory on the basis of sex. But the suffragette movement was active since 1906 in England, solely concerned with votes for women.
Votes for women!
Votes for women!
Our daughters' daughters will adore us, and they'll sing in grateful chorus. Well done, sister suffragette!
Men that were involved in the suffrage movement, and there were many more men campaigning than women, were in favour of votes for everyone, not just votes for men.
If most men could not vote in 1906, why would women start a radical movement concerned only with a women's vote?
Why is it that in my own school education, I was taught that only women were denied the vote prior to 1918? It was never mentioned in class, nor clarified in my textbooks, that men were also denied the vote.
So, before 1918, in your mind, do you see it that men could vote and women couldn't?
Yeah.
But before 1918, you had to own a certain amount of land in order to be able to vote. So there were many, many men that couldn't vote either. But would you say that you were less aware of the men not having the vote than women not having the vote before
I was
then?
Less aware. I mean, thinking about it, I guess I knew. But I was, yeah, it didn't really raise up into the issue, which it should have done. Yeah, because it is very much a class issue, and it always was very much a class issue rather than a gender one.
So men have not always had universal suffrage, and voting was linked to class and wealth. But wouldn't that mean that there would have also been some female voters before universal suffrage was given to women? From the Telegraph. Women voted 75 years before they were legally allowed to in 1918. A new document has surfaced which shows British women, of all classes, voting in 1843. Some 75 years before they received the parliamentary franchise in 1918. History professor Sarah Richardson explains what this discovery means and how it was possible. Occasionally, just occasionally, you encounter a document that radically changes your view of the past. This happened to me very recently. The source was just a few scraps of parchment in a box of solicitor's papers in Lichfield. But, at a stroke, it provided me with tangible proof that Victorian women were not only eligible to vote, but actually exercised that right, some 75 years before they received the parliamentary franchise in 1918. The document in question was a poll book for the election to the local office of Assistant Overseer of the Poor, in the parish of St. Chad's, Lichfield in 1843. I was tipped off about its existence by a friend, Philip Salmon of the History of Parliament. It was a schedule of voters, their addresses, the rates they paid and how they voted. But as I looked down the list of names, some immediately jumped off the page: Elizabeth Shorthouse, Hannah Holliman, Phoebe Skelton, and Mallet. In all, there were 30 women playing an active role in the election. Although I knew that in theory women retained the right to vote for some local officials in the 19th century, I had never seen any evidence of them doing so in practice. This lack of evidence had led me, and many other historians, to assume that voting was entirely a male prerogative before the 20th century. In the period before the secret ballot, everyone was entitled to know how people voted. It was unusual to have an election for an assistant overseer. This was a powerful post responsible for collecting poor rates and deciding how they were allocated. But the overseers were usually appointed to avoid the expense of an election. All heads of households, paying rates, were entitled to vote. This was a very wide franchise, and one that included single and widowed women. My assumption was that the women would be of genteel status. But as I checked their names against the 1841 census return, I was surprised to see the diversity of the group of voters. There were a few women of independent means, owning property and land. There were also women, probably widows, who had inherited their husband's businesses. So, for example, the wealthiest female elector on the roll was Grace Brown, a butcher, who managed a large household including several servants. Due to the high rates that she paid, Grace was entitled to 4 votes in the election, which she cast in favor of the conservative candidate. But I was amazed to see many women on the list who were far lower down the social scale, including the laundress, Caroline Edge, the servant, Sarah Payne, and even paupers, including Sarah Batkin of Stowe Street. The poll book is all that remains of an unremarkable local parish election in a comfortable Midlands market town in the mid-19th century. Yet, it has prompted a need to rewrite the history books by providing the first substantial proof that women were able to vote long before they received the parliamentary or municipal franchise. Voting had more to do with who paid tax than restricting people based on gender. Unfortunately, even today, this attitude is still proposed by some people. From Huffington Post. Godfrey Bloom, ban unemployed people from voting. Godfrey Bloom has called for unemployed people to be banned from voting, in a call derided as social apartheid. In a controversial blog for the Huffington Post UK, the independent MEP, who was stripped of the UKIP whip for jokingly calling a room full of women sluts, said the electoral system needed to give more electoral power to the wealthy who create the revenue. The former UKIP business spokesman attacked the fact that some will still get a vote even if they have contributed nothing to the national exchequer at all and maybe never will. He added, "I do not expect to vote in a Unite ballot because I am not a member and pay no dues. I do not expect a vote at Marks and Spencer's AGM because I am not a shareholder. We need to get to a system where the interest of the individual and the state are more compatible. But let's look at universal suffrage outside of the United Kingdom. Here in Australia, males achieved suffrage in the 1850s, and females in 1894, so about 40 years difference. Although true universal suffrage wasn't achieved until 1962, when Aboriginals gained the right to vote. In Canada, both males and females achieved universal suffrage in 1920, but the First Nations people were excluded until 1960. New Zealand achieved male suffrage in 1879, and female suffrage in 1893. In the United States, all males achieved suffrage in 1868 with the 14th Amendment. And women achieved suffrage in 1920 with the 19th Amendment. Although African Americans' right to vote was restricted in some areas due to poll taxes, literacy tests, and grandfather clauses, so universal suffrage was not truly achieved until 1964 with the passing of the 24th Amendment. There are also a number of countries that achieved suffrage for both males and females at the same time, for example, Thailand in 1933, Taiwan in 1947, South Korea in 1948, Poland in 1918, Malta in 1947, Lebanon in 1943, Israel 1948, Indonesia 1955, India 1950, Ghana 1951, Finland 1906, Chile 1970, and Bolivia 1956. The history of democracy is a complex mess, with restrictions on class, race, gender, and literacy, changing from country to country. And the concept of universal suffrage, where these restrictions don't apply, is relatively new. There are in fact many parts of the world which still don't have universal suffrage. Hong Kong, for example, by 2017 hopefully will have a new system to elect the Legislative Council via universal suffrage, but the new system, once developed, will need the approval of Beijing. Universal suffrage is just over 100 years old, and the concept of democracy is barely any older. Considering the 200,000 years of humanity's existence, these concepts are like newborns. To claim that all males have always had the right to vote, while this has always been denied to all females, is sheer ignorance. But before moving on with the next part of this video, I should make one more important point. Universal suffrage for males came with the additional responsibility of being required to defend your country during wartime. In fact, the right to vote for males is still tied to the draft to this day. True equality would abolish this requirement, or alternatively make it universal.
There's Susan B., Anthony,
yeah,
and Julia Howe,
Lucretia
Ma,
and others.
Their shoulders howl, they carried signs and marched in lines until at long last war was passed.
Oh, we were suffering until the bridge.
Oh.
Not a woman here could vote no matter what age. Then the 19th Amendment struck down.
restrictive rule.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm going to say something really dangerous now. When you have a society where women's main currency is really their sexual favours, their ability to reproduce, then a lot of what women do is a form of prostitution. For example, I would argue that traditional marriage, which included conjugal rights, particularly when women were not able to go to work or were fired when they first got married, and were basically selling their bodies and their reproductive rights to their husband, he bought them, by giving her room and board in return, was a form of prostitution. So I think we really have to discuss what we mean by prostitution. At least the women who choose it as a career choice, freely and uncoerced, that's very, very important, only have to put up with their customer for about an hour. Once upon a time, it was a lifetime, ladies, a lifetime.
So traditional marriage, was it a form of prostitution? Did it enslave women? Or was it a socially constructed mechanism to help facilitate reproduction? To find out the origins of this, I think we need to once again look at tournament species and pair bonding species. But just before that, let me stress something. In this section of video, I will be discussing the origins of traditional marriage, the reasons behind traditional marriage. But that does not mean that I support traditional marriage in modern society. Now, obviously, I respect the rights of the individual to choose what they want. If there is a man and a woman who choose to live in a traditional marriage, then that's fine. That is their choice. That is their lives. They can do it if they want. But I don't think in a modern setting that we should be restricted to those traditional roles. And I think in a modern setting, those traditional roles can have negative effects on both males and females. But once again, that is entirely up to the individual. So before one of my opposition tries to strawman me and say that I'm a traditionalist and promoting traditional marriage or traditional gender roles, that is simply not true. I am simply discussing the origins of those gender roles and traditional marriage and why they played an important part in the historical context. But anyway, let's have a quick look at tournament species and pair bonding species with Professor Robert Sapolsky.
Armed with these sorts of principles, you could now look at all sorts of interesting domains of animal behavior and understand what the behavior is going to be like by using these. Okay, we start with the first example. Here we return to these guys, and we have one species here, and knowing this guy had a penis and this one nursed, we've got an adult male and an adult female. What is it that you can conclude in this species? Males are a lot bigger than females. So let's state it here as there's a big ratio of males to females. Meanwhile, in the next county, you've discovered another species where somebody's got a penis and somebody else is nursing, and their skulls are the exact same size. Oh, here's the species where there's no difference in body size between males and females. Okay, so let's begin to see, just using the principles we've got in hand already, what sort of stuff we can predict. Starting. Okay, which of those species? In one case, you have males being a lot bigger than females. In one case, you've got males being the same size as females. In which of those species, the first one like this, or the same size ones, in which ones would you expect to see more male aggression? First one. Okay, how come? Their bodies are built for it, which begins to tell you something. Their bodies are built for it, maybe because females have been selecting for that. You will see higher levels of aggression in species like this, where there's a big body size difference, and much less of it in these guys. Next, you now ask, how much variability is there in male reproductive success? In one of these species, all the males have one or two kids over their lifetime. In another species, 95% of the reproducing is carried out by 5% of the males. A huge variability skew in male reproductive success. which species do you get the every male has a couple of kids and that's about it and all equally so? Which one? Second one, how come? Because these guys are being selected for aggression. If they're fighting, there is going to have to be something they're fighting for, differential reproductive access. Okay, so you see more variability in species that look like this. Next, females come into the equation. What do females want? What do females want in the species on the left versus the one on the right? The one on the right, you know, again, skull's the same size, same body size. On the left, what does the female want? What sort of male is the female interested in? Big, exactly. That's exactly the driving force on this. How come? Because she's not going to get anything else out of this guy. This guy is just going to, like, the present is going to be some sperm. It might as well be some good sperm, some genetically well-endowed sperm that makes for a big, healthy offspring, increasing the odds of her passing on copies of her genes in the next generation. What about in this species? What's females looking for? Okay. Good. Hold on to that for a second, and let's jump ahead a few lines. One of the species, males have never been known to do the slightest affiliative thing with infants. They just get irritated and harass them and all of that. And the other, you have soccer dads who are doing as much raising of the kids as the females are. In which species do you get lots of male parental behavior? The one on the right. Okay, so lots of male parental behavior here. So somebody just gave the answer here, female choice. What would you see in this species? You want big, muscular guys. You want whatever is selling that season for what counts as a hot male because you want your offspring to have those traits. And somebody else called out here, what do females want in this category? And what was it you said? Good personality, yes. Able to express emotions. That too. Okay, somebody else shouted out something that gets at the broader, more globally Oprah version. Okay, somebody shouted out parental behavior. You want a male who's going to be competent at raising your children. What is it that you want really most deeply? You want to get the male who is the most like a female you can get a hold of. You don't want some big old stupid guy with a lot of muscle and canines who's wasting energy on stuff like that that he could be using instead on, you know, reading Goodnight Moon or some such thing. What you want instead is somebody who's as close to a female as you can get to without getting this lactation stuff. Males are chosen who are the same size as females. So the term given here is, you know, choosing for paternal behavior, parental behavior, or parental, let's just put that in there. And that begins to explain the top line, species in which there's a lot of sexual dimorphism, morphism, shapes of things, sexual dimorphism, big difference in body size as a function of gender. And in these sorts of species where you get male parental behavior, not much variability, male reproductive success, low levels of regression, and what females want is a competent male, these are ones where you see low degrees of sexual dimorphism. So how's a female going to figure out that this guy is going to be a competent parent? You know, once again, we just figured out if he looks kind of like you, because that suggests he hasn't wasted health and metabolism on stupid, pointless muscles when there's more important things in life for making sure your kids have good values. What else would the female want to know when she's first considering mating with the male? Is he a nice guy? Is he sensitive? Does he express his feelings? Is he competent at being a parent? What do you want the individual to do? Prove to you that he can provide for the kids. And suddenly you have a world of bird, male birds, courting the females by bringing them worms, bringing them evidence that they are able to successfully forage, they are able to get food. Female choice is built around appearance and behavioral competence at being able to be a successful parent in order to pass on as many copies of genes to the next generation as possible. Okay, how about lifespan? In which species is there a big difference in life expectancy as a function of gender? First one, here you've chosen for males to be as close to females as possible, and thus the physiology. Here you got these guys who are like using huge amounts of energy to build up all this muscle, which takes a lot more work to keep in calories, and you're more vulnerable in famines. You've got these males with high testosterone, which does bad stuff to your circulatory system. You've got males who, thanks to all this aggression, are getting more injuries, more likely in species in which you have a lot of sexual dimorphism in body size, you get a lot of sexual dimorphism in lifespan. And then you look at these guys, and it's basically no difference by gender. Moving on, considering primates that are one of these two patterns, in which one do you always want to give birth to twins? In which one do you never want to give birth to twins? Who gives birth to twins? The one on the right, of course. How come? Because you got two parents on the scene. You were not a single mother, and you were a single mother rhesus monkey or something, and you give birth to twins, and you do not have the remotest chance of enough energy, enough calories on board to get both of them to survive. A twin that is born in a species like this has the same rate that it occurs in humans, about a 1% rate, and it is almost inevitable that one of them does not survive. Meanwhile, there's a whole world of primate species with this profile where the females always twin. Finally, you are the female, and you are contemplating bailing out on your kids and disappearing because there's some really hot guy over there who you want to mate with, and you are trying to figure out this strategy. So you are going to leave and abandon your kids. In which species do you see that behavior? The one on the right. The one on the right, because you bail out and the male is there taking care of them. You bail out in here and you've lost your investment and copies of your genes for the next generation. You see female cuckoldry, this great Victorian term. You see females cheating on the fathers in this species, but not in species like this, because the father is long gone in, you know, three other counties there courting somebody else, and doesn't matter, you're not going to get any help from him. In primate species of this profile, you always see twinning. And they both survive. And what studies have shown in these species, and we'll get to them shortly, is after birth, in fact, the males are expending more calories taking care of the offspring than the females. Go bail out on him and go find some other hot guy, which in your species counts as some guy who looks even more like you than he does in terms of what you want out of the individual, so that...
Yeah, I know that was kind of a long clip, but it's kind of important for this next section, so I want to play it in its full context. So the purpose of evolution, the goal of evolution, is for an organism to pass on their genes. So with human males, there are basically two different strategies to do this. The first one is the tournament species, or the tournament strategy, I should say. Now, in this strategy, an individual male sleeps with many women, many females, some of which will become pregnant, and some of the children of those pregnancies will survive to adulthood, thus passing on their genes. Now, this is a numbers game. So, obviously, the more females the individual male sleeps with, the more likely he is to pass on his genes. Now, I should note, I'm not talking about modern times, I'm talking about pre-contraception times, where basically every time you had sex, there was always the possibility that it was going to result in a pregnancy. Obviously, with the invention of the pill and many other contraceptive means, this has changed a great deal. But I'm going back, you know, hundreds of thousands of years to discuss the origins of marriage. So obviously this was pre-contraception. So with the tournament strategy, a high-status male who slept with lots of different females had a fairly high chance of passing on his genes. He obviously didn't put time and effort into raising the possibly numerous offspring he had, but it was basically a numbers game. Now, obviously, not all males could do this. Not all males are high-status males who were capable of sleeping with numerous women, which is where the pair-bonding strategy comes into it. in this strategy. A male bonds or pair bonds with a female. They have children and they raise the children together. They both spend time, effort and resources in raising these children. So in this strategy, the male doesn't have as many children, theoretically, as the tournament strategy male. But he puts more time and effort into those children he does have, thus maximizing their chances of survival. Now, before going on, please let me stress one particular thing. I know I'm heading into pickup artist territory here, so please just let me stress, I am in no way promoting the pickup artist's view of alpha males and beta males and all this other bullshit. I'm just talking about this stuff in a historical context, in a context of evolution and mating strategies. And of course, once again, let me stress, I respect the rights of each individual to choose how they live their life. If you want to settle down and have some kids, that's fine. If you want to play the field and sleep with lots of different partners, that's fine too. And that goes for males and females, by the way. Your body, your life, your choice. So just to be clear, I'm not promoting pair bonding or tournament strategies. I'm simply discussing them. So basically, there was those two different strategies for mating and passing on your genes when it comes to males. But what about females? That's a bit different. Now, there is clearly a disadvantage for a female who has mated with a male using the tournament strategy. Once again, we're talking about in a historical context before there was welfare, before the government supported single mothers. Okay, 100,000 years ago, we didn't have a government which supported single mothers. So I'm talking, once again, in a historical context, not in a modern context. So the tournament strategy disadvantaged women because they were left to raise and care for the child by themselves without a partner to help them raise the child. Of course, they may have received help from their family or the community at large, but this placed the burden on their family or the community at large. Now, when it came to pair bonding, this wasn't the case. Obviously, you have two parents there to care for the children and share the load. So, from a female perspective, the pair bonding strategy is a far better strategy because both parents shared the load. And the origins of marriage can be found in this pair bonding strategy. It's basically religion or tradition or the government making this type of mating strategy official. So in essence, traditional marriage was formulated, was invented, was created to benefit women, as it ensured that there would be a partner to help raise the children. And sex outside of marriage became taboo because it could lead to unplanned pregnancies, where the burden of child rearing was placed squarely on the shoulders of the mother, or alternatively had to be taken up by her family or the community. So restricting sex within marriage was a way of ensuring that society became a pair bonding society. Now, of course, this didn't stop people sleeping around before marriage or cheating on their partners. Humans will be humans after all. But this also brings up the concept of chastity, because if you're going to have a male which commits himself to the pair bonding scenario, the pair bonding strategy, to traditional marriage, where he is going to spend his life supporting the mother and the children, he wants to know that those children are his. It would be unfair and unjust if a man worked a shitty or dangerous job his entire life raising children which he thought were his but in actual fact weren't. Once again, the aim of evolution is to pass on your genes. And if you're actually supporting another man's children, thinking that they're your own, then you're actually helping another individual pass on his genes, using your labour to do so. So the idea of chastity was kind of an insurance to ensure that the children that a man was raising would be his own, that the time and effort that he invested into those children would ensure that he is actually passing on his own genes. Now, if a woman were to cheat in a marriage, there's the possibility she might become pregnant, and that that man may be in fact supporting another man's children. Now, no doubt there will be many people who see all of this as unfair and restrictive. And you know what? Maybe you're right. But the point is, it was practical. Now, obviously, in modern society, we have the luxury of contraception, which means sleeping around before you get married doesn't take the same risk of unwanted pregnancies. Obviously, unwanted pregnancies still occur because people don't take the proper precautions, or in some cases those precautions simply don't work. But we also have the modern safety net of the government looking after single mothers, where the father isn't present or isn't playing an active role in the child's life. These are advantages, what you might even call luxuries, of the modern age. Obviously, 100,000 years ago, these didn't exist. So traditional marriage was created to benefit reproduction, and in many ways to benefit the female, as the alternative may see her raising a child by herself, which was obviously a massive disadvantage in those times. So the question, once again, is did traditional marriage combined with traditional gender roles enslave women? Was it designed to treat them as second-class citizens? Well, the answer is no. The purpose of traditional gender roles combined with traditional marriage was one of reproduction, of supporting a mother and her children. Now, was this in any way restrictive? Well, yes, of course it was. But not only for the woman. After all, the man was responsible for the entire family.
You ever think that maybe marriage wasn't a way to force women to become slaves to men? You know, bear men's children and provide them with free domestic services the way so many second-wave feminists have portrayed it. But maybe it was a way to force men to become slaves to women, to support women's children and provide provisioning and protection services to women. You ever wonder? Just maybe it was both?
In media and things like that, we often see the stereotype of the abusive drunken husband who, you know, after work goes to the pub and gets blind drunk and comes home and is abusive. Now, no doubt that this stereotype is based on some truth. No doubt there have been men like that, and probably still are. But this is hardly behavior of someone who is happy in their life. If you're a privileged king, as feminists would have us believe, you're hardly going to go away and drink yourself into a stupor every night and then come home and take out your frustrations on your wife. These are the actions of someone who is frustrated and angry at their life. These are the actions of someone who feels trapped. Now, I'm not excusing those actions at all. I'm just examining the cause, or a possible cause. And we really shouldn't be surprised if someone is stuck in a dead-end, thankless job which eats away at them day after day. But they have no choice but to do it because they're in a position of being the provider protector. We really shouldn't be surprised that if someone does feel trapped in that position with no possible way out, that they would turn to alcohol and take their anger out on someone else. So the very concept that traditional marriage and traditional gender roles were put there for the benefit of men and to disadvantage women is sheer nonsense. Now, no doubt, like I've already stated, no doubt they were restrictive. But those restrictions served a function, there was a practicality at the time to those restrictions. There was a purpose to those restrictions. Now, in today's modern age, there isn't such a need for such restrictions. We have things like the pill, which allows people much more freedom in their sex life. We can test the genetics of children to see if the father is actually the father. We have things like daycare, which helps free up women's time to pursue a career, which takes much of the pressure off the fathers. And of course, we also have the option of the father staying home and the mother going out and providing for the family. Of course, there's also the option of not getting married or not having kids. I think all these things are good things. I think all these things are positive things for the most part. But to say that we should have had these things 100,000 years ago, or 10,000 years ago, or 1,000 years ago, or even 200 years ago, is lunacy. These are products of our modern age, and it's taken time and effort for society to evolve and to reach this level, not to mention the scientific breakthroughs for some of it. So it's not fair to judge the past by our standards today. So once again, let me stress, no doubt, in the past, traditional marriage, combined with traditional gender roles, has been restrictive to both males and females. But those restrictions did serve a purpose, a greater good. They were practical at the time. Unfortunately, the way feminists tend to look at this, though, is they only see the restrictions placed on women and conclude that those restrictions were done for nefarious purposes, while ignoring any restrictions placed on males and only seeing the benefits to males, while ignoring the benefits to women, and concluding that societies back then should have been exactly like ours is today, or somehow even better.
We for centuries have been rolled over by God the Father, have we not?
Men have taken the responsibility of looking after the people they love, and they've taken the responsibility when they sacrifice.
Women haven't. Are you suggesting that women haven't?
But men have taken the front line to the outside world. Women take the responsibility of their families and their husbands and looking after them, and often the head of the family.
Husbands. That's another patriarchal construct.
And it's women who want husbands, or did. When they needed them.
I doubt it.
They did. They needed them.
I doubt it.
You're old enough to realize that our society was very different in the past.
Yes, it was more patriarchal.
Because it had to be for survival. It had to be for survival.
Societies are very, very complex mechanisms. And unfortunately, the way feminists tend to look at past societies and even society today is they only see the negatives that affected women and only the positives that affected men, and in many cases, the minority of men. They don't look at the whole picture, and they don't look at that picture in the context of the time. And then they call this patriarchy. And I'm sorry, but that's bullshit. Now, I'd much prefer living today where we have more options and more choice. Hopefully we all agree on that. And I'm a huge supporter of women's rights. I'm also a huge supporter of women's responsibility. That means if women want to earn the same amount of money as men do, they need to work the same jobs and work the same number of hours, and they need to make sacrifices in their families. That's sacrificing time with their children. Unfortunately, women aren't willing to do this, most women anyway. If we look at the divorce statistics, most women want custody of their children. Now, I can understand this, but you've got to realize that there is a consequence to that action. And that's what feminists seem to be blind to. They seem to be blind to the fact that when men work longer hours and earn more money, they're actually sacrificing time with their family, time with their children. And see, this is the problem. Feminists look at the positives for men and the negatives for women, and that's it. They don't look at the whole picture. Now, sure, yeah, in the past, women didn't have the same career choices as men. And as I've explained, there were practical reasons for that. You may say this was unfair, and maybe it was unfair. but it was practical at the time. And if you look at the whole picture, then you have to look at the fact that men were also trapped in those roles. They were expected to fill those roles because it was practical at the time. You can't look at only the men at the top, those who have been the rulers and the kings for the last, you know, thousands of years, without looking at all the men at the bottom who have gone off to war and sacrificed themselves and died to protect their wives, their children, and their country. Now, feminists, dismiss this as, well, that was men killing men. But that's just a simplistic, bigoted way of looking at reality. Unfortunately, war is part of human nature, whether it be based on competition for resources or competing ideologies or whatever. It is, unfortunately, a reality. And if we had have been under female rule for the last 100,000 years, there still would have been war. There still would have been competition for resources. There still would have been a clash of ideologies. And most likely, it still would have been men dying on the front lines. Of course, what I've presented here is just a small snapshot. In a video around an hour long, obviously I can't go into every detail of every culture for the last 100,000 years. So think of this as a simplistic overview. I've tried to be fair, though, and I've tried to be much more balanced than the simplistic view presented by feminists, which is only half the picture. So anyway, folks, that's it for this video. I'll try to get the next episode done a lot quicker. But until then, always remember,
don't drink the poison Kool-Aid.
In this short film, you will be learning about democracy. Some terms to know are democracy. The democratic process began way before people existed in the world of ancient birds. This group of feathered friends are the first example of democracy ever created. The Osonio Repdimo birds of northern Wallachia voted on which member of the flock gets to eat the other members. This species became extinct rather quickly because votes usually ended in ties. Down in Kansas City, a man named Wally Churchill, half-brother to Winston Churchill, relaxed on his private beach off the coast of the Pacific Ocean. When he saw these strange creatures, he wrote in his diary that night, "Wah!" Wally Churchill is now known as the inventor of modern democracy, and tofu. But democracy came first. Following his book, Democracy, How I Created Democracy, Churchill inspired the wonderful people of Australia to adapt his train of thought, and sure enough, Australia became the first country to incorporate voting into their secretive society. America followed 3 years later, just coming off of the heels of the invention of thunderclouds. Think of democracy as a silly putty. It changed forms over the course of the 4,967,000 years it existed. For example, in 1975, democracy was defined as a sneeze in which, instead of the usual honking noise, one's nose screams in pain. At present, democracy is defined as democracy. Well, that's all you need to know about democracy. Thank you for listening, and let this theory guide you through the future election process come around voting time. Remember, if you don't vote, vote doesn't you.
Be like, oh, that's all your feminism. That's all your feminism. I double dip, 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 dip. I double dip, 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 dip. I double dip, 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 dip.